Hi everyone, thank you for joining us today for a virtual tour of Vulcan Park and Museum. I'm Casey and I work in the education department here. I'm so excited to have you and I hope that you enjoy this introduction to our museum, which focuses on the history of the city of Birmingham and of course Vulcan himself. Today we will be learning about the iron making process. If you have any questions, please comment below and be sure to follow us on social media for more information and our next episode. Thank you.
So now we're about to go inside the museum. Our museum at Vulcan Park is set up like a time machine. We're going to start in the late 1880s and go through the 1920s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, all the way up to present day Birmingham to show you that timeline of who we were and who we are today. Here we are in the late 1880s, early 90s. Birmingham is only about 40,000 people. Everybody worked directly or indirectly with the iron and steel industry. And there was a lot of competition, and there was a need for more people to work. There weren't enough people in Birmingham at that time to work in the iron and steel industry. If you look over to my right, we have the three ingredients to make iron and steel. Here are samples. You have the iron ore, the limestone, and the coal. You take all three of these rocks and you put them in a blast furnace and you melt them at over 3,500 degrees and it comes out like hot lava out of a volcano. Once it gets to that point, you pour it into the mold, whatever it is you're making, and once the mold cools, then you break it apart and you have the item that you make that you're making. Now, taking consideration, Vulcan's head is huge, so they didn't have a lot of computers and all kinds of mechanical equipment to make these molds and cast the iron, so it was all done by hand. Remember, we're in 1904, so things were done by hand, and it was an undertaking to make a statue that big. I want you to look at this picture on the wall of all these men who worked in the mine shafts. It was dirty work, it was unhealthy, but there was a need for iron and steel. Birmingham's economy was booming. There were demands for iron and steel all over the world. So every able body was able to work in the minefields. They would have to break away these rocks with tools, and they'd have other guys lift up the rocks and bring them to the train cars and take them to the foundries where they would make iron and steel. At that time, in downtown Birmingham, down in the valley, there were 12 blast furnaces. Every one of them were making iron and steel. We have one left that's now a museum, which you're familiar with, and that's Sloss furnaces. A lot of people didn't have houses and places to live, so the company that you worked for actually gave you a house to live in. They were called company-owned houses. And there was a lot of competition in the iron and steel industry in Birmingham with the companies and the railroads. So in order to keep employees, they would give them a house to live in and even pay them with their own money so they would spend it in their own commissary. They didn't have grocery stores and shopping centers like we do today, so they had what was called a commissary. And we set one up called the Vulcan Commissary. And if you look in here, you can see where there's a butcher at the top. People would go hunting for their own food. They would bring deer or other meat here for the butcher to cut and then to sell to other people. Also, the post office was here. People would bring their mail here and sometimes get their mail there. It was sort of a general store, if you will, where people would congregate and meet with each other after work. Television wasn't even invented at that time, but radio was, and every commissary had a radio. So people would come and listen to music, period music, or sports, or news. So it was a time when people just worked and went home and occasionally went to the commissary. Life was very simple at that time. People got around by walking or riding horses. There were very few cars around. It was a different place to live altogether. Now we're going to move into the 1920s era of Birmingham. So we went through the late 1800s. We went to the early 1900s. Now we're going to go into the 1920s. So if you look at this picture, it shows four old buildings. That is now a historic site in Birmingham. Birmingham was the first city in the South that had four skyscrapers or four tall buildings at one intersection. They were all built in the late 19-teens and early 20s. At one time, it was called the heaviest corner in the South, and then it was actually changed to the heaviest corner on Earth. So I know you've heard that the city has been called the Magic City, but if you're wondering where it got that name, this is the reason. When Vulcan was at the World's Fair in 1904, millions of people from around the world saw that statue. It was amazing. No one could believe that somebody could build a statue out of iron as tall as a five-story building. And people were saying, where did that statue come from? Who built that statue? Oh, it was made in Birmingham, Alabama. So all of a sudden, people knew that Birmingham was in the iron and steel business, and they knew there were jobs here. So people started to move to Birmingham from all over the world. They came from Asia and Africa, Germany, the Middle East, from all over the world. And all of a sudden, Birmingham's population tripled. It went from 40,000 to 120,000 people by 1920 in just 16 short years. And it grew so fast, it was like magic. And that's where the city got its name, Birmingham, the Magic City, because all these people started to move here from all over the world. We had a huge diverse population at that time, and we still do today. Birmingham Southside has the most diverse population in the state of Alabama to this day as a result of all those immigrants coming here in the early 1920s. So when all these people came from all over the world, they brought their customs with them. They brought the type of food that they ate. They brought the type of architecture that you're, and all of a sudden, there's a need for architects, doctors, lawyers, preachers, teachers. Birmingham is becoming a big southern city, bigger than a lot of other cities in the South at that time. Iron and steel industry was just booming, and there were calls for iron and steel all over the world.